Hello, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Sharon Menezes. I am associated with the Center for Criminology and Justice, School of Social Work, Tata Institute of Social Sciences. The topic of this module is engaging with the field, and this is part of the paper on fieldwork and field supervision. I'm sure most of us and most students of social work have heard of the concept of engaging with the field. Supervisors may have spoken about it, and at some level all of us are engaging in the field during field practice. However, because this is such a crucial process in field practice, we feel the need to speak and discuss about our engagements, because fieldwork is based on the level of engagements in the field. For students of social work, fieldwork offers scope for doing and learning from doing, of course. However, the foundation for any kind of learning through doing lies in the level of our engagement with the field. So what does engagement with the field actually involve? In simple terms, engaging with the field means engaging or occupying ourselves or involving ourselves with people in the field. It also involves engaging with individuals, groups, communities, government administration, staff at the fieldwork agency, our field supervisors, our colleagues, our student colleagues who are placed with us. Very importantly, when we talk about engaging with the field, we also speak about engaging with our personal and our professional selves. For instance, we need to reflect on how we think, how we feel, how are we addressing our prejudices, our biases, etc. We may have seen that in every field situation, we are likely to come up with challenges. So regardless of whether we are students or experienced social workers, the field does throw up several challenges. Some field contexts are relatively easy to work in because the people we work with are open to us, they want us to work, and there is a common objective between the people and between the social work agencies. However, there are some field contexts which are resistant to social workers. And it is here that social workers need to work with resistance and hostility. I will speak a little about engaging in the field in the face of resistance and hostility in the field context. This is an illustration where students of social work were placed in an agency that conducted informal education programs in a community. And when the students entered the community, they realized that the community youth were not interested in informal education, but they were interested in jobs. So the students also realized that the community members, especially the youth, felt that the NGO staff and the students were disturbing the community members, and they didn't want to interact with the students after some point in time. The students were not really sure what to do because they had two options. The first option was to leave the community because the community youth didn't want the students. And the second option was to abandon the objective of education and training and instead search for jobs for the youth. Now, the youth were more interested in jobs and they were not interested in earning and training programs that the NGO personnel were offering to them. They had a discussion with their field supervisor, and their field supervisor suggested that they continue to engage with the community members in order to understand their challenges and also understand the needs of the youth in that community. So in consultation with their fieldwork supervisor, the students planned their activities in such a way where they established rapport with the community youth. They told the community youth that they were interested in understanding their problems and their issues. They interacted with a local school teacher to understand why the youth were dropping out of school. They got in touch with the experts in the education sector. They spoke with the elders in the community. And over time, the students suggested to the NGO that they design a different kind of a program that was along the lines of an earning and learning program. Now, this earning and learning program was something that the community youth appreciated, and they showed interest in this program. What I'm trying to say over here is, had the students left the field or had the students refused to engage with the community youth, they would not have reached a point where they could have communicated to the NGO and even arrived at the suggestion for the NGO to start a different kind of a program, that is the earning and learning program. So what I'm trying to say is that it is important for social workers to acknowledge that they are likely to encounter differences in the field. There would be differences of opinion with clients, differences of opinion with NGO staff, with government administration, and we need to work with these differences. We cannot get away with these differences. To work with these differences, once again, we require to engage with the field and the people who we come across in the field. We also need to keep in mind that when we talk about engaging with the field, we also are including our engagements with involuntary clients. When working with individuals in the agency, we come across voluntary clients and involuntary clients. Voluntary clients are people who want help from the social worker, and it is possible for the social worker to sit with the voluntary client and work out a plan towards bringing about change. An involuntary client is one who does not want to be with the social worker. He or she does not want to accept help from the social worker, and there is a difference in the agenda between the agenda of the social worker and the agenda of the client. It becomes very necessary to engage with such involuntary clients, although there is a difference of opinion and there is a difference in agenda, because if social workers do not engage with these clients, nobody else will. And in the process, these involuntary clients will get further marginalized. So for instance, if we are looking at prisoner groups or women who are engaged in commercial sex, they may not really want to enroll into rehabilitation programs or other programs of the NGOs because they have their own challenges and they have their own set way of thinking. The objective here is not to force ourselves onto the person. Engaging in the field does not mean that we force ourselves onto the clients, but it means that we engage with the person, we offer what we are offering in terms of services, and we allow the person to decide whether he or she wants to accept our services. So pursuing engagements in the field help us to learn about ourselves. It helps us to learn about the challenges of the people that we work with. And it also helps us to address conflict situations. Now, the extent of engagements in the field will vary from person to person. And this will also depend on our interest to work and our interest to learn from the field. Engaging with people in the field requires us to make special efforts to extend our outreach to people. We cannot expect people to come to us and we don't always have a situation where a client or a community or a group approaches us and seeks help. We need to take that initiative as social workers and engage with people in the field. Sometimes our interaction, as I said, is easy, and in some situations it is not so easy. So for instance, there was a student who was placed in a shelter home for women who were rescued from commercial sex. Now the women wanted to get discharged from the institution, and they requested the student to help them to get a discharge. The student was not in a position to facilitate this kind of discharge because it was not really in her hands. It was the court that decided her discharge. So when we talk about engaging with such groups and in such situations where the interaction is difficult, it requires us to actually explore how we are going to engage. So is our engagement going to be in the form of a conversation? Is our engagement going to be in the form of recreational activities? Is our engagement going to be in the form of calling in resource persons to provide information to the women? Is our engagement going to be in the form of mobilizing resources for the women? We need to somewhere go back to our classroom learning and explore the different techniques and the tools of social work. And this could offer us as a guide in terms of how we can engage with the people that we are working with. So what facilitates engaging with the field? A few points that could act as a guide. A few processes that facilitate some engagements in the field are openness to learning. We need to be open to learning. We need to engage in experiential learning. We need to plan our field work. We need to analyze our experiences and engage in critical reflection. We need to record our fieldwork experiences. And finally, we need to find ways to enjoy the fieldwork. we will briefly look at each of these processes and see if we can use these as guides for our fieldwork. The first point, that is being open to learn. Now, being open to learn is the basis for any form of learning. I'm sure we all realize that. And such openness is not necessarily given. So I may know that I ought to be open to learn, but I may hold certain prejudices and biases that actually make me closed to learning. Firstly, I need to be aware of these prejudices or biases. There may also be some situations where I'm not convinced and I don't want to accept or I don't want to listen to another person's perspective. There could also be a situation where I feel threatened. So if there is somebody who has a different approach or somebody who has a suggestion to give me, I may feel threatened and I may not really want to accept that person's perspective, because in a way I want to assert my own perspective and I want to demonstrate that I know everything. So there are several processes that may actually close my learning and hamper my learning in a way. In order to be open to learning, we need to accept that there can be different views and it is okay to have different views. For a social worker, accepting these different views and working with different views becomes extremely important, because in the absence of differences in approaches, one is not going to be able to design a comprehensive plan for our client group. Being open is one of the attitudes expected of social workers and social work learners, because only then we can listen to the voices of the people that we work with and the communities and the groups that we also work with. Importantly, being open to learn also means being open to unlearning. We need to unlearn certain concepts that we have in mind and somewhere also be willing to adopt different perspectives and different attitudes. I will illustrate this with an example. There was a student who was placed in a prison, and the student did not want to be placed in the prison. So initially the student requested to be placed out of prison, because somewhere the student felt that people in prison were immoral, they were bad, they were wrongdoers, and they did not deserve help. Now, being in a social work college, the student found it very difficult to negotiate with the supervisor change in placement, and somewhere the student felt that she was being forced to be placed in prison for a fieldwork. Over time, the student started interacting with the prisoners and the prison staff and the social workers of the agency. And then the student realized that the prisoners were women like her. And somewhere she reached a point where she said that these were women who were in some ways similar to her and in some ways different from her. So she realized that these were women in prison, they had children, they had relationships, they had desires very similar to her, and they also faced certain challenges. These were poor women. They lacked education, they lacked vocational training skills, they lacked family support. They lacked legal aid, they didn't have assistance, they didn't have the means to appoint lawyers. Being open to learning meant not just understanding the context of the client group, that is the vulnerabilities of the client group, but it also meant exploring why other people work with different groups. So her fieldwork supervisor then asked her to also approach different social workers, and she went around, she met different social workers and asked them a single question: why do you work with these people? Okay, what is motivating you to work with these people? In time, she realized that social workers had different objectives and there was a value in working with this group. Over time, she developed her own perspective. So it required her to unlearn her own perspective towards prisoners. And this does not really require a person to parrot another perspective or to adopt another perspective without really thinking about the perspective. A person can stick to his or her own perspective, but if a person really engages in the field and is open to learning, then it's possible to have a more rounded and a more holistic perspective, because now you have your perspective that has emerged from the field. You have also explored the different other perspectives, and you now have an informed perspective. So being open to learning helps you to have a more informed perspective. Engaging in experiential learning is also very important for engaging with the field. We have some earlier literature and social work textbooks that indicate to us that all learning is rooted in experience. Such learning from experience offers continuity, that is, learning creates opportunity for further learning. Once again, I will illustrate this with an example. There was a student who was placed in an institution and he was working with juveniles in conflict with the law. Now he decided that he wanted to work with this group, but he also realized that he was not very comfortable working with these children, with the juveniles. So he shared this discomfort with his supervisor, and the discomfort was coming from two sources. Before I continue, it's very important to always remember that we need to share processes with our supervisor if we, you know, want to expand our learning goals. So as I said, his discomfort was coming from two sources, he realized during the discussion with his supervisor. The first source was the ideas that he had about the juveniles. So these were juveniles, these were young boys who had run away from home or who had gotten into fights with neighbors. Some of them were also involved in eve teasing. Some of them were accused of cases of rape in the sense they had eloped with girls who were below 18 years of age, so it amounted to rape. So he was not comfortable with the fact that these were children who had got themselves involved in activities that other children do not get themselves involved in. Secondly, he was not comfortable working in groups. Now we know that group work is a very important method in social work. So he was okay working with them as individuals, working with a few cases that he was in constant touch with, but he didn't really want to work with them in groups. Along with his supervisor, they worked out a set of tasks that would help the student to deal with this kind of a discomfort. So coming back to experiential learning, if we have to engage in experiential learning, we have to reflect on our experiences, identify areas where we are learning, identify our challenges, identify our discomfort, and that experience then becomes a basis for setting future learning goals in our fieldwork. There was another case of a student who was placed in a community that was inhabited by women who were engaged in commercial sex. It was something like a red light area, but not exactly that. Now she found that many of the women were suffering from chikungunya at the time of her fieldwork. And she initially looked at it as a health problem and she approached it as a health issue. So on the one hand, she mobilized resources for medical aid. On the other hand, as she started observing the context, the field context, she also realized that there were serious sanitation issues over there. Sanitation was very bad. There was no proper drainage system. She also somewhere then reflected on her own life. She was also a woman. And in the conversation she had with her supervisor, there was this kind of discussion in terms of the disparity between her situation and the situation of the client group. The one issue that came up was that in middle-class families or in mainstream contexts, the issue of sanitation and drainage was taken up by certain communities and certain citizens groups. But when it came to the women who were engaged in commercial sex, there was nobody who was interested in the issue of sanitation and drainage. So this became her second learning goal. This led her to start work with the sanitation department of the local municipal corporation. The point over here is that the student did not stop at mobilizing health resources, but she used her observations to get to the root cause of the problem. Once she did that, she addressed not just the health issues, she was also, more importantly, able to communicate the problems of the community with the concerned authorities. Now, the concerned authorities were of the opinion, they thought that you know, the people on contract system, the necessary workers were doing their job, and sanitation and drainage was taken care of. So the student played a very important role of taking an issue from the community to the local authorities, and this was done on the basis of her regular reflections, on the basis of her observations. In the process, what I'm trying to say is that experiential learning, reflection, analysis of observations help a student and a social worker to identify new learning goals. Once the student identifies the learning goals, there is less dependence on the fieldwork agency, there is less dependence on the fieldwork supervisor, and this brings in a level of confidence in the student. So what has happened now is that initially we had the fieldwork agency and we had the fieldwork supervisor who was directing the student. Now the student has moved to a level where he or she has gone to the agency, has identified tasks, and has taken ownership over the issue. So the student is responsible now for identifying the issue. The student is responsible for planning out the intervention program, and the student is responsible for implementing the intervention program. Besides increasing the level of confidence in the student, it also makes learning an enjoyable experience for the student, because now the student feels responsible for fieldwork. The next process that is very important for engaging in the field is planning for fieldwork. It seems to be obvious that everybody plans for fieldwork, and very often we are likely to have our supervisors tell us that, you know, we need to plan for fieldwork. We know that we need to plan for fieldwork, but before going to the field, we are also caught up with many other tasks. So we are attending our classes, we are doing our assignments, we have other extracurricular activities, and we go to field without planning. Very often, even as social workers, not just as students, we find ourselves going to field and then trying to figure out what it is that we need to do. Now, this is not a very healthy practice. A healthy practice is to plan what we want to do in the field. What is the objective for visiting a community? What is our plan when we are interacting with an individual client? Okay, what is it that we want to discuss? What are the issues that we want to address during that particular session? Planning for the field, in a way, will also help us to develop ourselves and to prepare ourselves for that individual session or a meeting with a group or a meeting with a community. So what does planning for fieldwork include? Planning for fieldwork includes planning fieldwork tasks. What is it that we are going to do? Who are we going to meet? What are the appointments that we need to take? We need to review our past work. If we are meeting a client, we need to also assess, we need to think back about our past work. What are the issues that we have already covered with our clients? What are the issues that need to be covered with our clients? We need to also keep in mind that we are networking with other social workers, we are networking with other social work agencies, so we need to plan our meetings with them. And very importantly, we also have to plan our meetings with our supervisors, with the agency personnel, and with our student colleagues. A process that we cannot talk enough about is analyzing our fieldwork experiences and our critical thinking. We cannot underestimate and we cannot talk enough about analyzing experiences and critical thinking in the field. Analysis and critical thinking involves what? It involves examination of our beliefs, of our assumptions, our reasoning. Why are we involved in the field? Why are we engaging with people? What is our purpose of working with the field? What is the thought process that is going on in the field? Okay, what are we thinking when we are in the field? We need to analyze these experiences. We need to reflect on it. We need to talk about it. This reflection is also important for arriving at our own perspective. Now, engaging in the field and doing the tasks that we are assigned without actually critically assessing it does not really amount to learning. So it is preferable that analysis and critical reflection is undertaken by the learner alone, and also through discussion with others. So when I talk about others, I'm talking about the fieldwork supervisor, the other students who are in fieldwork, the agency personnel, experts in the field, teachers, etc. What I would advise is that every day after fieldwork, if a student can spend a little time with, you know, himself or herself alone and note down a few points in terms of what is it that they have observed in the field, what is it that they have experienced in the field, what are the situations that they have encountered in the field. I would recommend that students reading this module also have a look at a self-exercise that is listed in the module, because it would help us in our engagements with the field. Analysis may be ongoing. It doesn't necessarily have to happen at the end of the day or the end of the week. It could be ongoing. It happens during the time we are in the field. It can happen daily. It can happen on a weekly basis. It can happen at the completion of a set number of activities. So supposing we are in an organization that is conducting a workshop or a conference. Okay, at the end of the conference, we may decide to critically look at the entire experience and look at our experience. Something that I want to say is that this ongoing analysis will help us to work along the continuum in social work. When we are looking at the continuum in social work, it is very important for social workers to be always aware that there are three levels of intervention. There is intervention at the micro level, at the meso level, and at the macro level. With analysis, the social worker, along with the supervisor, is able to, as I mentioned, identify different learning goals, but also identify how one can intervene at these different levels. So if we go back to the example of the student who was placed at the community that was inhabited with the women who were engaged in commercial sex, her initial entry point was to work on health issues because there were women who were suffering from chikungunya. It's only later, through her observations and through her analysis and exploration, that she realized that the problem is not just a medical problem, it is actually a problem of sanitation and drainage. And this led her to work at the meso level, which took her to the local municipal authorities. So this was a student who moved from the micro level to the meso level. Recording fieldwork is extremely important. It sometimes is a boring activity. It takes a lot of time. We are very busy people. But without recording fieldwork, our engagements and our learning is only half complete. Recording of fieldwork helps us to reflect on the field experience and our field learning. It helps to spend a little time not just on noting down what really happened, but also to note down what we think about it. So if there was a situation that we encountered in the field, for instance, if we saw a fight between two neighbors, okay, besides noting down the process and the reason for that fight, what do we think about it? Why do we think that fight happened? What were the processes that happened? Who were the people involved in the fight? How was the conflict resolved? Was the conflict not resolved? Who were the people who were trying to resolve the conflict? We analyze that entire experience and we record these processes. Our recordings are read by our field supervisor. So we need to remember that if our field supervisor is there to guide us, then it becomes important for the field supervisor to read these processes. Recordings also offer opportunity for students to record how they were able to relate the classroom teaching with the field, or how they were not able to relate the classroom teaching with the field. So fieldwork is there to help us develop certain skills. We have classroom teaching and we have fieldwork in social work education, and arriving at a point where we are able to translate our classroom teaching in the field is extremely important in social work education. The supervisor plays a very important role, and students are encouraged to write regularly how they are able to translate classroom teaching into their fieldwork practice, where they are finding it difficult, where they think that it is not possible to relate classroom teaching to field practice, etc. We have some barriers to engaging with the field, and we need to be conscious about these barriers. These are barriers that all of us face, experienced social workers, students, fresh social workers, everybody. What are these barriers? Our preconceived ideas and biases about people, about certain situations, lack of sharing with the fieldwork supervisor, disinterest in learning. If we are not interested in fieldwork, then that in itself is a barrier. Not finding meaning in fieldwork, lack of clarity about our role and direction in fieldwork, physical illness and fatigue. We also have to look up after ourselves. So if we are tired, we are not going to be able to engage with the field. Difficulty in receiving feedback. So being close to learning, being close to feedback and other perspectives is another barrier. Poor listening skills and lack of self-reflection also reflect that we are closed to learning. I will sum up with just three points that we need to consider. Firstly, we must remember that engaging with field is an experience that is unique for every individual. So experience engaging in the field has several purposes that go way beyond the fieldwork agenda. And it is these engagements that help us to develop our personal selves as well as our professional selves. And ultimately, the personal self and the professional self are both interlinked. Engaging with the field involves an active and dynamic interaction unfolds between the learner or the social worker and the field. Engaging with the field goes beyond merely doing in the field. It involves a higher level of participation by the learner or by the social worker. And we have also seen that often, long after a student has passed out and completed training, it is these engagements that the student remembers and reflects on while working as a professional social worker in the field. To sum up this module looked at what engagement in the field involves. It looked at certain factors that help us to improve our engagements in the field, and it also touched on certain barriers. I hope a few of these, the pointers in this discussion will help us in our engagements in the field. I would like to suggest that you read the content in the module, because this is discussed in further detail there, and we also have a self-exercise that you can go through during the course of your fieldwork. You can share the self-exercise with your supervisor and take what has value for you and discard what does not have value for you. We have also included some references at the end of the text, so if you are interested, you can read further and develop your understanding on engagement with the field. Thank you.